When I was a kid, I was very unhappy. Lonely, shy, very shy. Not too many friends. I lived in my own imagination a lot. I performed. My bedroom was a stage, and I performed. And I played LPs from Broadway shows, and I would dance and sing with them. I lived in my own world.
I worked in the film industry. I was assistant to the president of Columbia and then United Artists, and my job was to find writers and find stories. We were the king of the heap. We made movies like Suddenly Last Summer and Bridge on the River Kwai and Lawrence of Arabia and Dr. Strangelove and Pumpkin Eater, and I mean, go on and on.
I was at this time being psychoanalyzed every day. And I grew up in London psychologically and creatively. I'd always wanted to write. I'd always been afraid to write, like most people are terrified of writing, especially past a certain age. You're almost afraid to start.
And through the analysis, I was able to work through all of that. And the first thing I really wrote was my screenplay for Women in Love, which turned out to give me a certain amount of confidence.
That's when I became a writer.
You have decided, for the purposes of Faggots, to create a character who I assume is yourself, Fred Lemish.
Yes.
Who is on a quest to find love before he's 40.
I'm 43.
There's a personal strand, which is the character of Dinky. Dinky is clearly the love of the life of the main character of Faggots, and as it turns out, Dinky would be the love of Larry Kramer's life in the person of David Webster, on whom he is based.
Faggots. It was about trying to get this one person, Dinky Adams, to be my lover, who I was desperately in love with, and who is my lover today, but that was a long time ago.
Do you know what it's like to have 18 of your own friends in a year and a half die? Men who are at the height of their creative usefulness to society, all men under 50 years old. I don't think the straight community has any concept of what it's like to be a gay man in this city. It's like living in wartime. You don't know when the bomb is going to fall. Who is it going to hit? What is this mysterious thing that is in who? Do I have it?
I knew that I had to write something. I had to get the message out.
Larry was doing what he is programmed to do, which is turn life into art.
I was not trying to present myself as a hero. I was trying to present myself as a pain in the ass. I was pushy, 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 and I was difficult to get along with, and I was obnoxious, and I did alienate all these people who were my good friends.
The horror of this disease gives the character Ned a purity of focus that I think he didn't have prior to that time. And I have a feeling that very much so happened with Larry. There was a monster that was so big and so mean that all of his anger that was looking for a place to focus itself had a very pure and very clear and very clean focus.
You can get it too! You can get it too! You can get it too! Release the drug!
We were united in anger because the occasion of ACT UP was such a fiery speech that Larry gave that led to an angry demonstration out in Wall Street.
This is just the beginning! This is just the beginning!
Why can't you call a plague a plague? Every time you say the words AIDS epidemic, you are lying. You must learn to say the words AIDS plague, plague of AIDS, plague, plague, plague.
We have to start being powerful or we are going to die.
There is no question that it all took longer than it should have. Huge amounts of time. And those drugs are out there because of us. And that cannot be disputed in any history that's written.
If you look at medicine, it's broken up into two major areas.
There's medicine before Larry Kramer, and then there's medicine after Larry Kramer and his army of activists. The world of science didn't get it. They got it because it was their lives and their people and their loved ones, and they turned it around.
He was unafraid of being unpopular. He was brave. He was tenacious, extremely complicated, and a great writer.
I belong to a culture that includes Marcel Proust, Walt Whitman, Tennessee Williams, Alexander the Great, so many popes and cardinals you wouldn't believe. Mr. Green Beret, did you know that it was an openly gay Englishman who's responsible for winning World War II? His name's Alan Turing, and he cracked the Germans' Enigma code. After the war was over, he committed suicide because he was so hounded for being gay. Why didn't they teach any of that in the schools? A gay man is responsible for winning World War II. If they did, maybe he wouldn't have killed himself, and you wouldn't be so terrified of who you are. That's how I want to be remembered. As one of the men who won the war.
Hello. My name is Will Schwalbe, and I was lucky enough to know Larry all my life. Or, as Larry liked to say, he knew me before I was born. My mother and Larry met in the 1950s, when they were both in their 20s, and sat side by side working for two different Broadway producers. They were young and energetic and crazy about theater and New York. They were a little like Rock Hudson and Doris Day. Or to be more precise, they were very much like Rock Hudson and Doris Day. They became dearest friends and would remain so all their lives. When I was 16 and just about ready to come out of the closet, Larry was the first adult I told. Well, actually he was the second, but he liked the idea of being the first. So I never corrected him. Larry soon became my dear friend and lifelong mentor. Larry wrote in The Tragedy of Today's Gays that I was quite possibly the only person in the world who could get him to do something when he had dug in his heels otherwise. That's going to be on my tombstone. And I have the honor of being co-executor with David Webster of Larry's estate and being his literary executor. Now, today I want to tell you a secret about Larry, but it's not really a secret because it's known to everyone here. And that is that while Larry was famous for being a fierce combatant, he was as much a teddy bear as he was a warrior. Larry was funny, warm, incredibly supportive, often silly, prone to burst into song, and filled with love. It's no accident that Jean Carlomusto called her wonderful documentary, from which we've just seen clips, Larry Kramer in Love and Anger. Love came first. Here are some of the things that Larry loved. Larry loved writing. He often said he lived to write, and he was brilliant at it, creating some of the greatest works of our time. The screenplay of Women in Love, his groundbreaking novel Faggots, his essays and speeches, the plays, of course, and his staggeringly brilliant two-volume magnum opus, The American People. I had the extraordinary experience of sharing a flat in London with Larry while he was writing The Normal Heart, and I got to read it as it emerged from his typewriter page by page. Larry's love of writing and revision was evident in every line. Larry loved being gay. To quote him, "I love being gay." Larry loved David Webster, whom he famously hit in the face in Fire Island Pines, a scene only barely fictionalized in Faggots, and whom he later married. David Webster was the love of Larry's life, and everyone who met Larry knew it. Larry loved his brother, Arthur, and he loved Arthur's children. Larry loved Yale most of the time. Larry loved New York all of the time. Larry loved writing scorching emails with hundreds of CCs. Especially when he thought he or our community or one of his friends had been wronged. Larry loved his friends, and he loved getting us to confess our deepest secrets, but he was incapable of keeping them secret. He once told David Webster he lived for gossip. Larry loved his terriers, Molly, Tiger, and Charlie, and Larry loved life, which is why, against all odds, including staggering medical challenges, he clung ferociously to it. Larry fought fiercely, but he loved fiercely as well. I think that's why he fought so hard for all of us. Larry saved countless lives through his righteous rage and the power of his voice on the page and in person. I loved Larry. He was my second father. They say, don't meet your heroes. Well, I can't imagine my life if I hadn't met mine. I want to share some words Larry loved. They're from the W.H. Auden poem, September 1st, 1939, which in a different stanza gave Larry the title for his most famous work, The Normal Heart. There is no such thing as the state, and no one exists alone. Hunger allows no choice to the citizen or the police. We must love one another or die. Larry, the world is falling apart without you. We all are. We need you more than ever. And I miss you terribly, Larry. Always will.
Calvin Trillin. What? Better? I apologize for my voice. In 1997, my younger daughter Sarah and I both contributed to an anthology of essays on Larry Kramer. Mine began like this. When I was asked if I could write about some aspect of Larry Kramer's life, I said, I might be able to write a piece about Kramer as a pain in the ass. But I suppose you have too many of those as it is. In Sarah's essay, she recalled, among other things, the jolly Christmas dinners Kramer had regularly attended at our house, and said when she heard him called the most belligerent man in America, she couldn't believe they were talking about her sweet Uncle Larry. I usually called him Kramer or Nedster, a reference to Ned Weeks, the pain in the ass. Character in The Normal Heart that he bravely based on himself. We had been classmates at Yale, but we didn't get to know each other until our 15th reunion. Kramer, who had been miserable enough as an undergraduate at Yale to try suicide, was a regular at reunions. I can still picture him chatting amiably with a cluster of our classmates at our 35th, everyone wearing the official reunion baseball cap that said Yale 57, except Kramer, whose cap said in large capital letters, ACT UP. Acting up was his default mode. When I mentioned to a newspaper editor friend that I was driving Kramer to another reunion, our 45th, he replied, I've been a bit cool on Larry since he accused me of murdering my friend. Talk about hypersensitive, I said. He probably wasn't even mad. He had, after all, thought nothing of calling Anthony Fauci, who eventually became his ally and friend, an incompetent idiot and a murderer. He had disrupted church services and funerals, but he was indeed a sweet uncle to our girls and a devoted friend to me and to my wife, Alice. She agreed to read the 1,600-page draft of his first novel and reported back to Kramer that it could do with some cutting. One March, Kramer wrote the president of Yale a long letter criticizing the university's handling of a noisy AIDS protest. He sent me a copy. I got copied on a lot of Kramer correspondence, most of it vituperative. Deep in this letter, Kramer told the president that he was so disappointed in the feeble support his straight friends had brought to the AIDS fight that he hadn't been able to face coming to our house the previous Christmas. Odd sort of RSVP, Alice said. Kramer pointed out that Sarah pointed out that I might have been one of the disappointing straight friends Kramer had in mind, a reminder of those infuriating GMHC gents in the normal heart who were always telling Ned Weeks that it would be more effective if he toned down the hyperbole and the vitriol and the guerrilla tactics. When Kramer decided that his paper should be housed at Yale, the negotiations expanded to discuss getting the page done. I think Will glued these together when we said it. Sometimes contentious of gay issues in the curriculum and the campus life. Eventually, though, differences were settled, and in time to have an exhibition and ceremony during our 50th reunion weekend. Several years later, Kramer and I drove to New Haven for a commencement rather than a reunion. Yale had awarded him an honorary degree. It was awarded, the citation said, for courage and tenacity in speaking out and acting up. By then, I had recognized a fundamental fact about the most belligerent man in America. He was right. When it came to what had to be done and what wasn't being done to combat AIDS, Kramer was right. People were dying, and he understood that polite requests to the medical establishment were not going to save them. In other words, my friend Larry Kramer, the Nedster, was essentially a pain in the ass as a matter of policy. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Tonya Pinkins. And I'm grateful for this opportunity to talk about my friend, colleague, hero, Larry Kramer. I first met Larry when I auditioned for his play, Just Say No. I was a new mom. They graciously allowed me to bring my firstborn son, Max, into the rehearsal room with me. And it was intimidating and overwhelming. I would say that I was apolitical. I was working with extraordinary artists, Kathy Chalfont, David Margulies. I just felt like a fish out of water. Almost every reference in the play was unbeknownst to me. I had to look up the writers. I had to look up the references. And in the process of trying to live up to Larry's work and to the extraordinary artists that I was working with, it changed my life. I went in to just say no, apolitical, and I came out incredibly politicized. And Larry became a hero for me because he's someone who took something that was a challenge in his own life and he turned it into a cudgel to change the world and make people face up to discrimination and the wrong things that are happening in the world. And since that time, I have been inspired to do the same in every way that I could, everywhere that I could. And I really do owe that to Larry, who was a friend and a supporter and a mentor and who changed my life. Rest in power. I know that you are giving them hell up in heaven.
Thank you so much. It's a real privilege and an honor to have been asked by all of you to be here with you this evening to pay tribute to my very dear friend, Larry Kramer. So let me bookend the evolution of our enduring friendship. The date is June 26, 1988. A one-way conversation from Larry Kramer to Tony Fauci via the written word in bold letters in the Sunday magazine section of the San Francisco Examiner, reflecting a booming voice before I had even met the man. Quote, "I call you a murderer," an open letter to an incompetent idiot, Dr. Anthony Fauci, unquote. Fast forward 32 years, May 2020, a brief two-way telephone conversation ending in a simple phrase. Larry, in a voice halting and weakened by years of a series of chronic illnesses, whispering, "I love you, Tony." Tony, holding back the tears, replying, "I love you too, Larry." What happened during those 32 years that brought us to that last encounter was truly historic, since Larry was the initial driving force that changed forever the relationship between the advocacy community and the scientific and regulatory establishment. Larry was the battering ram who not only opened the door for his younger acolytes to participate in the formulation and implementation of the scientific and regulatory agenda of HIV/AIDS, he crashed it down. Along the way, Larry and I developed, as he has often described, a complex relationship. I would become all too familiar with the tactics that he had mastered to an art form. Confrontation, outrageous behavior, anger, and insults, followed by insight, rationality, sensitivity, vulnerability, empathy, and even humor. I began to appreciate that it was pure passion related to his concern for the plight of his people, the gay community, which drove him to outrageous behavior in order to gain the attention of the government and the general public concerning the disaster of the HIV/AIDS epidemic. As we got to know each other better over the years, it became clear to me that despite his confrontative behavior, Larry had a pure, simple, an unselfish goal. There were no hidden agendas with Larry. His passion was pure and his commitment unflinching in his attempts to jar people into realization of the seriousness of the AIDS epidemic. I quickly realized that despite his sometimes outrageous behavior, he was as noble as the most respected scientist and public servant. And so we became brothers in arms. Nonetheless, Larry also became ambivalent about his closeness to me, his former nemesis. And he continually pushed me to do more. A typical example, he felt strongly that I should chain myself to the White House fence. And as he put it, embarrass the president into speaking out more on AIDS and providing more funds for AIDS research. I explained to him that this would be 15 minutes of attention and I would immediately lose all access to the White House. No matter, he still felt I should do it. In another example of the complexity of our relationship, Larry graciously invited me and my wife, Christine, to be his guests at the New York opening of The Destiny of Me, right here in this theater. Although Tony Della Vita, the character who represented me, was trashed as expected, he emerged as a complex person in a subtly sympathetic way. At the end of the play, Larry rushed towards me in the back and asked apologetically, "Are you pissed off at me?" I told him that the play was masterful and that I was not offended at all. His relief was palpable. Years later, as his physical condition deteriorated, I would occasionally visit Larry in his apartment and in the rehab center on the few times that I would come to New York. During a private dinner that he threw for just the two of us in his apartment, we reminisced like two aging warriors who recalled the battles that we fought together, how we evolved from adversaries to friends, and how much we cared about each other. On the last occasion, when I was leaving his apartment to return to Washington, we gave each other a prolonged hug. And as we parted, he said with a mysterious smile, "I still think you should have chained yourself to the White House fence." A complex relationship indeed. I am so pleased and grateful that the last words we had the opportunity to say to each other in May 2020 was, "I love you."
Kushner. I have a thing. I have a thing for cranky old Jews, and although it was my admiration for Larry's activism and for his writing and for his extraordinary artistry, once we became friends and began having lunches and telephone clatches, it was my thing for cranky old Jews that made me really love him. He reminded me of my Aunt Martha. He relished the world. He took a deep delight in learning about it and especially in regaling others with tales of the world's wickedness. He adored the revelation of hypocrisy, the pettiness and grubbiness and kinkiness behind grand facades. What made dishing with Larry so piquant was the pleasure was that his pleasure was suffused with guilt over the sin of gossip, over the schadenfreude, and I imagine some vestigial shtetl dweller fear transfused across generations through Jewish DNA of being overheard, of getting in trouble for telling secrets, for telling out loud, or even in whispers, the secret way the world works. Larry understood how the world works. His understanding wasn't derived from any theory, at least none that he cared to identify as such or to interrogate or struggle with. Larry, in my experience, was allergic to theory. He'd unconvincingly plead incomprehension every time I tried to discuss anything abstract. And theories about LGBTQ plus oppression made him grouchy, then furious. With Larry, that was always a short trip. Especially if he heard that these theories were being taught at Yale. What Larry had was tzerchel, an untranslatable word for an untranslatable kind of knowing, a wisdom compounded of smarts, perception, gamesmanship, wit, a healthy or maybe overly healthy dose of cynicism, a refusal to be left in the dark, a profound faith in human agency, and an even profounder conviction that life is fundamentally tragic. I think what Larry liked best about me was that I loved his writing. He disapproved of pretty much everything else about me, and when that disapproval changed into wrath, in an eye blink after putting our orders for lunch at the Union Square Cafe one day, well, I'm sort of surprised to find myself speaking at Larry's memorial because he blew up our truly lovely friendship, and I'm not ashamed to say I begged him not to do it, but he couldn't. And he broke my heart. We eventually reconciled, and I told him I loved him. I guess I'm ashamed to say that that was only partly true. I loved him, but I also didn't, not in the way I had before. I couldn't find my old love for him again. I wasn't sure if I should say that today, but all of us over the years have been to memorial services at which Larry spoke, and well, I think I'm on good behavior comparatively. Even when I was at my angriest with Larry, and this too is something I know I share with others in this room, I never lost my admiration for him as an activist and as an artist, admiration bordering on a kind of awe. Even in watching him immolate a friendship that I know meant something to him, even as I was appalled by witnessing rigidity and zealotry triumph over love and loyalty, I have to admit I was also rather impressed. I felt a peculiar privilege having a front row seat to a fire that was in its own way so pure that at times it seemed almost unearthly, fueled by consuming itself, yet unlikely, almost miraculously unlikely, ever to expire, not until the expiration of its vessel, its acolyte. I told Larry long before our shipwreck, when I was scolding him for anathematizing some other poor sap, that he reminded me of George Bernard Shaw's Saint Joan, irresistible and unendurable, glorious and awful in equal measure. I think Larry filtered out the gist of that and took away only that I said he reminded me of George Bernard Shaw and Joan of Arc. But there was something, some flame, awesome and terrifying and heroic and pure and unassimilable and impossible, burning in Larry and burning him up while also feeding and driving and ceaselessly revivifying him, scorching all sorts of people, some deserving, some not, some ambiguously figured, all burned in Larry's crucible, along with the ground and air we shared with him, and we put up with it because we know, that many of the structures of our wicked world need to be burned to the ground. As I mentioned, Larry loved it most of all. Larry loved it most of all that what I loved most of all about him were his words, his plays, his essays, his novels. I loved the torrential voluptuousness of his Jeremiads, the elegance and the vulgarity, the informed analysis and the volcanic, Cassandra-like leaps into prophecy. I loved how Larry's fearless, scrupulous truth-telling coexisted with his unapologetic, equally fearless addiction to overstatement. I love what's implicit in his accuracy and in his hyperbole. We are in crisis, our lives are at stake, we alone can save ourselves, and circumspection will lose the name of action, and we must act. I love Larry's moral insistence on the mortal threat posed by denial of mortality and reality and the holocaustal consequences of choosing the false safety of submission over our fears of the difficulties of resistance. And perhaps most of all, I love those moments in Larry's plays and his masterpieces, The Normal Heart and The Destiny of Me, when, because Larry was an artist, a great artist, the roar of his holy fire, his rigidity and zealotry, would give way to empathy and compassion and forgiveness. Those things are indispensable for playwrights. They're the essence of drama. Anyway, dear Larry, If there's heaven or nirvana, I know you arrived there in a chariot of fire armed with your bow of burning gold and your arrows of desire, and I hope that enlightenment includes your finally knowing for certain whether or not Lincoln was gay. But but I also hope that reincarnation is an option. I know if given a choice, Larry, you will choose to return. Please come back with all your thorns. You will always be needed.
Wow. I had forgotten, I don't know, somehow that Dr. Fauci was here opening night of Destiny of Me right here almost exactly 30 years ago. I played Larry as a young man in that play. And playing him allowed me to be me for the first time. You know, everybody was supposed to be in the closet, especially if you were an actor. And he was like, what are you doing? You know, I wasn't really in the closet, but I was like, it was just so, people were dying, and it was just like, what are you doing in the closet? It just felt so stupid. So I came out, I found myself as an actor. I played my first Jew. I felt honored as a Shabbos goy. If you're Jewish, I can turn on your lights. And being here with that incredible cast, Peter Frechette and Piper Laurie played his mom. I remember she didn't want to go upstairs, so she had her little dressing room under the stairs here on the ground floor, and she peed into a bucket. That for Larry. She peed into a bucket for Larry. And in rehearsal, I kept trying to cut my lines. And he was like, what kind of actor are you? I was like, but I'm saying the same thing two or three times. Isn't it more effective if it's once? He's like, you're not an actor. You're a director. And I took him to heart later. But most of my time was trying to cut my own lines. And it was the part on the stage that I was able to be myself most by playing him. And I reminded him that we had actually met under different circumstances at an ACT UP meeting probably a couple of years earlier when they were debating over at the center whether to shut down the bridges and tunnels the way they had done, a day of desperation, which they had done in San Francisco, right? And my brother who lived there was like, I don't know, Gianni, you know, ambulances couldn't get through and some people died when they did that in San Francisco. So at the ACT UP meeting, they're all like, close it down. And I was like, my brother said that people died when, you know, the ambulances couldn't go through. And he turned to me and said, we're dying, you fucking coward. I'm like, so that was the beginning. And then I had to play him, which saved my life in a way. So I'm going to sing a song that I sang in the play. I don't know if I'm going to get through it, but at the very beginning of this documentary, thank you, Sheila Nevins, for this documentary. He says, I lived in a fantasy world when I was a kid, and a lot of queer kids do, right? That's how we get through, and then we find our people before the internet, of course. Now there's Grindr. So this is a little bit of a song about that. Thank you, Jacinth. The game of just supposing is the sweetest game I know. Oh, our dreams are more romantic than the world we see. And if the things we dream about don't happen to be so, oh, that's just an unimportant technicality. Only make believe I love you. Only make believe that you love me. Others find peace of mind in pretending. Couldn't you? Couldn't I? Make believe our lips are blending in a phantom kiss or two or three. Might as well make believe I love you. Tell the truth, I do.
Thank you.
Hello. Thank you. Yes, yes, yes. A few years back, I was sitting home pouting heavily, grumpy, hostile. I had just done a play, and the world did not respond the way that I wanted them to respond, i.e. the critics, fuck them. And so I was pouting. And then I get a phone call from Joe Mantello and Daryl Roth saying, we had done a benefit reading of Normal Heart, and person who directed, Joel Gray, was no longer available, and would you do it? I said, sure, I'll help out. And helping out turned into having 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks to pull it together, to cast it, designers, the whole thing. And I had met Larry many, many times, and he was a force. And I went, okay, now I can either deal with the force, or I could do the play. I can't do both. And then I heard indirectly that he didn't like to go above the second floor, so we rehearsed on the third floor. And he never came to a rehearsal. And so just our last dress rehearsal before we started previews is when he came to see the show. And afterwards, he starts walking toward me. So I was going, okay, get ready for whatever this is going to be. Get ready. You don't know. You rehearsed on the third floor. It's your fault. If you had done it and on the second floor, maybe it would have been, you know, in increments. And he came toward me, and he said to me, I never knew I'd written a love story. And he hugged me. And it, and also at the time, the hearing aid was going off, so we were screaming about it. It was just sort of like surreal and beautiful and fragile and lovely. And then the next day, there was a letter that he had written that he wanted to put in the program. And it was, you know, AIDS in the current world and what needs to be done. And it was very, very intense, as is Larry. And he said, I want to do this. And I said, Larry, well, there's a whole generation who's completely clueless. And I want them to come in completely naked so that the full impact of the power of this play can hit them. And if they read anything, their guard is going to be on. I don't want their guard on. I want them to be fucked with in the deepest, most emotional possible way. And he agreed. What then evolved from that was one of the most extraordinary things I've ever seen. Every night after the show, he would stand in front of the theater and people would come out sobbing, grabbing him, hugging him, while he handed out this sheet of information. It was a moment of heart. It was a moment of
activism. It was a moment of him receiving the praise and the sense of celebration that he so deeply deserved. And it was a moment to remind me that it doesn't matter, ever. And I knew this, but we can forget it because we live in a silly, small world. The response to what you do does not matter in any way, shape, or form. It's the act of the doing and the reason behind the doing and the defiance behind the doing. And they will respond as they will respond. But Larry was this unbelievable shining beacon of choose it, do it, believe, fight. And he fought with rage, and he fought with his fragile, fragile, gentle heart. Thank you.
I'm Sheila Nevins, and
don't pretend you know who I am. I hate to tell you all this, but I was Larry's girlfriend. Now that may make it difficult for some of you, but that's too fucking bad. Darling David nicknamed me Tau. So my conversations with Larry, which began in the making of this wonderful Gene documentary, my conversations were always Dear Tau. Tau meant the other woman. And that was my name. I never asked who the other woman was. I'm not going to ask that question, okay? I'll tell you one Larry story quickly, and then I'll read my quick poem. One day, it was the first day of spring, and Larry was down at the village rehab. And I saw a bird cage in a window with these sort of stuffed birds, and they looked kind of real, and I went in and I bought it for Larry because his window was small. Kind of small in that room. And I got to the desk where you get checked in. And the guy said, you can't go upstairs, lady, with those birds because they're alive. I said, no, they're stuffed. They're not really real. But meanwhile, one was on a swing and it was swinging back and forth. And another was kind of on a sled and it was moving up and down. I said, no, they're alive. They're kind of like stuffed velvet and stuff. He said, can't go upstairs with that. It's hospital, rehab center. I said, well, do you have a boss? Can you call your superior. Some guy came out of the back room and he said, lady, what do you want? I said, I want to visit my friend Mr. Kramer and I want to bring this gift for him. And he said, what you got in there? I said, they're dead birds. They're dead. and they're okay. And he took off his glasses and he like poked them. And when he would poke them, they would swing back and forth. And I said, well, open it and squeeze them. You'll see they're dead. So finally he opened them, he squeezed them, they were dead. I got to Larry's room, and I said, oh, I'm so sorry, Larry. I was downstairs for like 15 minutes. These stupid guys downstairs, they thought the birds were alive. They gave him through the whole thing. They drove me absolutely crazy. He looked at this very strange gift, and he said to me, how do you know they're not alive? Well, that sort of brought me to today, because I really don't know that Larry's not here. Some way, I still ask him questions, because he used to give me hard, tough answers. Okay, my poem, my job. A documentary on Larry Kramer to be made. I had to know him to choose film segments of his life. He was sick and in hospital. And so I forced myself to make bedside visits. This led to an adoration of this gay icon. He had survived all the vulgarities of a liver transplant, HIV, and the maladies of an 81-year-old and the maladies of an 81-year-old who had lived passionately. Darling Larry, evolving into my muse, who would have thought? At first a stranger, with me at his bedside, telling him my boring stories, white lying about how good he looked. He, in gaga land of hoped recovery, occasionally bursting through with an insight. Pick your fight, he once said to me. I had been asking him why he didn't move on from seeking a cure for AIDS. What about cancer, I said. How dare I ask him to change gears when his fight had saved so many lives? How many men at how many events would bow down and thank him when we were together for saving their lives or their lovers or their children or their friends? No normal heart. This heroic man had the heart of Odysseus. How could I tell this hero anything about my life? Was he just tolerating me? Was this like fake familiarity? I was there because I had to know this man for this documentary, but I didn't expect to fall so madly in love. I loved that he fought to get healthy, defying odds again and again. I will not die, he seemed to say. I will not be forgotten, he seemed to say. Yet death hovered, and he was always challenged. And then slowly, as if a miracle not to be believed, he kept getting better. I loved that he looked forward to me and appreciated my visits. We fell in love over a hospital bed as I fed him applesauce. Have another spoonful, I begged. And I also once brought him an energy drink of papaya juice mixed with a raw egg. This is awful, he said. Give it away, he said. But Larry, it said it would make you healthy. I'll get healthy without it, Sheila, he said, but thank you. I played him show tunes on my iPad and we hummed and sang the lyrics we both knew. I brought him headphones for hearing better, even a birdcage, told you about that, a birdcage to celebrate the first day of spring. Once strangers we friended over curious details. Who wrote this? What plays were revivals? What was the zeitgeist? There I was, a straight, once young, once pretty docu-maker with this great hero. Both of us a passing prime, but rare and a go. I couldn't wait to see him each time, to watch his singular fight against impending death, and then to see him marry the beloved David Webster. We had nothing, yet we had everything in common. Raging insecurities. He encouraged me to write some stories, and so I did. And then I wrote, and then he said, some of them are good. On many visits, he would disclose that some other historical figure was gay. He definitely had proof. Mark Twain? Yes, he was a Clemens, and he used a pseudonym to hide his identity from his mother. And then there was George Washington. And then there was Honest Abe, not so honest. And then, of course, Hamilton. Is there anyone who is straight, I would ask, laughing. Larry took this question very seriously. I even began to wonder about myself. I asked him, what do you call a straight woman in love with a gay icon? A gay hetero? So I laughed. It was now to be LGBTQGH. Love for me was Larry. Once he suggested we run away to some island. You see, Larry was and is the most romantic man I have ever known. He made me feel pretty no matter how wretched or old I looked. Any visit would dissolve any of my headaches. He would say he missed me, adored me, wanted my visits, that I lifted his spirits. I felt a kind of lover's vibrancy that I was truly wanted there. I have never been so inspired. How dare I banter with this king? I heard he was cantankerous, so I must be a worthy subject. I heard he was difficult, but not with me. I never found anything but courage, longing, love, respectability, genius. Can you imagine this icon, tremulous? He continually questioned to me himself about his work, and at the same time, he could be brazen and brilliant. Oh, that Larry. I was in an unusual place to be with him. I was outed as special, surprised always by and en route to a mysterious moon. I was an earthling entering something surreal. Larry is from the sky to my earth. He lets me in and tells me to push on. I bring him silently an invisible halo. Once I brought him an I Love New York hat and he immediately put it on. He appreciated it. His aura is inspiration. Grant me more time. Spare Larry and me more time. I never displease him even when I displease myself. He provides a lesson in parenting. Only once did I disappoint him, this master. It was the day I mistook plain locks for Nova locks. I accidentally brought him the cheaper kind of salmon. He knew quality, that Larry. Nova was the truest of salmon offerings, he told me. Well, how was I to know? Well, now I did. Alas, I had failed him all over a common salmon sandwich. Forgive me, Larry, I said. He did it with a smile. Never again would I bring him cheap locks. But always again, I'll be there. Till next time. I love you, Larry. Thank you for being my unexpected discover late in life love. You are a dream. I am on your yacht. let's sail. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Peter Staley and Eric Sawyer and Ann Northrup. We are three of Larry's ACT UP children, and we're going to split this eulogy on behalf of a movement that saved us. If all you've known is that Larry Kramer loved ACT UP and we loved him back, you've missed our more complex relationship. As GMAC learned the hard way, and many of us in ACT UP witnessed firsthand, Larry was lousy at building and sustaining an organization. The flip side of the coin of love we felt for him was crowded with endless eye rolling. We lost count of how many times he resigned from ACT UP over truly petty stuff. And then there was the infamous harangues. Who can forget Vito Russo's memorial when Larry delivered one of the most offensive eulogies in history in front of the hardest working AIDS activists in the country? "We killed Vito," he bellowed again and again. There's no doubt that if Larry was delivering his own eulogy tonight, he'd blame all of us for killing him. Then call us turds. But all of this was family feuding. We loved him, and his legacy earned our deepest respect. Think about it. The two pillars of the gay community's glorious response to AIDS, the self-built care model that made sure none of us would die alone, and the civil disobedience movement that ranks as one of America's most effective. Neither would have happened without brave work of dozens and then hundreds of activists, but both were sparked by Larry's righteous rage. Our eye rolling masked our profound thanks. We love you, Larry.
To add to Peter's remark about Larry quitting ACT UP in a huff, just like when Larry went to stay with Will Schwalbe after being thrown off the GMHC board, during which time Larry wrote The Normal Heart, in two of his ACT UP breakups, Larry also picked up the pen and in 1988 wrote Just Say No, and in 1992, Larry wrote Destiny of Me, which, as we've already heard, premiered in this very theater. Larry always used his anger and his passion to tap into his immense creativity. You've heard about Larry the activist and the writer, but Larry was also a terrific friend. Larry was one of the first people I met when I moved to New York City in 1990, and he became one of my best friends and mentor. When I became symptomatic in 1982, Larry referred me to Dr. Jack Weissman, my first AIDS doc. Jack and Larry helped get my lover, Scott Bernard, into the first AIDS clinical trial run by Dr. Fauci for a drug called Suramin. It was never approved. Scott died in July of 1986. When Dr. Weissman died of AIDS, Larry referred me to Dr. Howard Grossman, who is here in the audience today. Hi, Howard. Howard was part of ACT UP at that time, but I had not yet met him. Larry's advice and mentorship helped me keep alive until the protease inhibitors and the AIDS triple cocktail restored my health. Like many young men my age, Larry helped save my life directly with those referrals and his guidance, but also indirectly through his activism. Larry, I love you and miss you dearly.
I co-host a weekly TV show with Andy Hum called Gay USA,
And in the opening 30-second title video, it's just a montage of people doing various things, but we have one person speaking, and it's Larry. A clip of him saying, "And we have to really escalate the noise we make so we'll be heard." And I think that was his motivation for everything. I've tried to figure out where Larry's rage comes from, and I heard something a few years ago that I, in my own unprofessional psychoanalytic mode, like to think is important. Yes, he tried to kill himself at Yale, but what I found out was that when he was at Yale in the 50s, there was a gay witch hunt that was going on, also at Harvard at the same time. And they would call in the students who they thought were gay, and they would confront them and try to get them to admit they were gay and ask them to name names of other gay students or faculty or whatever. And then try to send them to therapy, some kind of conversion therapy, which would be the only thing that allowed them to stay. And I can only imagine that that was one of the building blocks of Larry's rage at the stupidity and unfairness of something like that. And I know that rage he felt and his impatience with people who weren't angry at the same level. Because after all, we live in a world that we should all be rageful for at every single moment. We see it now, we've seen it throughout history. And I appreciate Larry's rage, and I identified with it. One of his last appearances was 4 years ago at the first Queer Liberation March in Central Park. He was in a wheelchair, he was in bad shape, and he was gonna live just a little less than a year. But he got himself there, and got others to help him get there. And he spoke to the crowd, and an adoring crowd, and yet Larry, of course, was yelling at them about what failures they were and what a failure he was and how, well, let me see if I have anything. We failed, we were too disorganized, we're not fighting back enough. America hates us, this was in the Trump administration. I love gay people, but I'm not so proud of us right now. And people would say, oh, we love you, Larry, ah, you're the greatest. So. It's a little surrealism in everyday life. He was not universally loved in ACT UP. Part of it was that he was so dogmatic about the need to just save lives, to get the drugs. And he was not at first open to the discussion of the larger issues around AIDS and the epidemic and the racism and the sexism and class issues, and it took a while, but he did come around and he did come to understand that this was a much bigger universe that we were dealing with. But there were a lot of battles. yes, a lot of battles. But he stuck with it. You know, he could have walked away from there at any, well, evidently he did walk away several times. But he remained passionately dedicated to his worldview and his insistence on the rage. But I also want to show you a picture that shows him not so rageful. And I'm glad Sheila Nevins has retired, because I always wanted to work with her. You haven't? Oh, okay. Well, then I'm destroying my future career aspirations with Sheila when I show you this picture. He had other girlfriends. Exactly. Well, this was 35 years ago, so it was before your time. But I'll show you one other that's Billy Goldstein sent me that as part of his research. And this is when I was jumping on the stage after he spoke to do a little ad for the first Queer Liberation March. And he tolerated my interruption, which I thought was very cute. Larry didn't, he's given too much credit for inventing things, but he had an irresistible spark. I remember one night at ACT UP when we were debating what to do about David Dinkins appointing the heinous Woody Myers as health commissioner of New York City. And, you know, are we going to do this? Are we going to do that? Can we do this? And Larry got up and he said, fuck all of you. Just go to Gracie Mansion and yell at him. And we all dutifully got up and went to Gracie Mansion. So all us brave activists. I, as you could see from that picture, I loved Larry too. I feel very, very privileged to have known him. He was a force in my life and in all of our lives. And how would I have met all of you without Larry? Thank you.
A reading from the book, according to the prophet Larry Kramer. Fellows are everywhere, still, once again, arm in arm, arms around shoulders and waists, everyone smiling. The dancing's over for this night. Haven't we shared a night of nights? A night of fellowship. Yes, we have braved and passaged all these rites together. Please turn to page 302 in your songbooks. Let us sing.
Walking down lanes of Aeon, and out of the grove.
The beach is filled with all my friends, all dressed in white. A huge white billowing tent awaits us. Someone is giving a dawn party, a welcome the new day party. All my friends, all sitting on the sand, arms around each other, touching, holding, sharing this moment. No one speaking. Yes, all my friends are here. It's hard to leave you. All this beauty, such narcotic beauty. Yes, it's hard to leave. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you.
Night of
night.
What a great night. I hope Larry's enjoying this. I know he's still pointing fingers at people. yesterday was his 88th birthday and the 53rd New York Pride March. Larry died 1,000 days ago, but I think about him every day, and it's nice to know by your presence here that you think about him too. And that you came here tonight to say thank you and goodbye to a very special person. I want to say thanks to you, to everyone who helped make this moment a reality. It was a big task. The idea, the production, the lighting, the movie, the sound, the set, the directors, the speakers, the performance were all perfect. I was in on the planning, but I was blown away by how it has all worked out. And thank you to my family and friends, and to my family of friends. We wouldn't have had Larry for the past 30 years without his doctors. Their care and attention, and really their brilliance, gave us this time. Larry, we know, was instrumental in getting the meds released to people who were dying, and he never stopped poking Dr. Fauci for the cure he felt was the necessary conclusion to the plague. The now Band-Aids that continue to garner money for the drug industry and the gay plague is now another one of the world's health problems. Dr. Donald Kotler, Dr. Alvin Friedman Keene were early supporters of Larry's health care. And as Dr. Jeffrey Green, our infectious disease specialist, who became Larry's main doctor. And Jill Frickenhaus is Dr. Green's nurse practitioner, who saw us through all the day-to-day problems that seemed to come up. In 1993, I was hired by Larry to find or design a house for him. After looking at countless houses, only two really looked at water, which was his demand. And I suggested, just by real estate terms, that he back off, maybe wait. And of course, he barked out at me, "You don't understand. I'm a dying man. I want this now." The project did bring us together, and the dying man got his house to live in, overlooking Lake Warmug in Connecticut. But after 5 years, Larry's liver was failing, and the experimental drugs that Dr. Fauci and Green were monitoring were no longer effective. Larry needed a liver transplant, and without a healthy liver, he would die. The one risk and the difficulty for the transplant was because Larry was HIV status. We arranged a visit to Dr. Fung at the University of Pittsburgh. He and his team were the only people who were at the vanguard, and Dr. Fung agreed to do a liver transplant on a co-infected person. They found a liver, and we moved to Pittsburgh. I fixed an apartment, and we stayed there for 4 months and went to the transplant team to check on Larry 3 days a week. The operation worked. We came back to New York, and Dr. Fung passed us to the only transplant doctor he trusted with Larry's life. We met Dr. Robert Brown, then at Columbia Presbyterian Hospital, and he became Larry's liver doctor. Bob was able to be here. Bob, are you here? Can you please stand up? Yes, thank you. Bob saw us every week and got Larry the next 22 years to finish his major book, The American People, to see his play, The Normal Heart, be taken to Broadway by Daryl Roth, to write the screenplay for The Normal Heart, and then finally to have Jean Carlomusto do the documentary, Larry Kramer in Love and Anger, produced by Sheila Nevins, the head of HBO's documentary. Unfortunately, caught in a glitch that was beyond my control, and despite the amazing care of Bob Brown, Larry went to sleep on May 27th, 2020, 5 days after I was allowed to visit him in the hospital. We all know death is inevitable. I saw Larry. We held hands. And actually, I believe Larry was really ready to let go. As I said, I miss him, and I miss this special person every day. And I'm thankful for the amazing life we shared, including our ability to marry the one we loved, and just like in every fairy tale, live happily ever after. Thank you.
Just remember and pretend that I've never been away. Will you, sweetheart?